Good morning. Could you share your outlook for each of the business segments to start off with? And then I have one follow-up question.
Sure. As far as the three or four businesses, let me put it this way, is first the international business, where things have stabilized and is very optimistic about the growth that we're seeing.
Yeah.
We'll end this year at about 1.65 million vehicles. For the next year, the budgets are yet to be made, so I won't be able to really put a figure, but at least about 10 to 12% growth on that side is assured. Secondly, what happens is that we are also seeing the mix change going in favor of even the motorcycles. So from the earlier Boxer 100, we're selling more of the Boxer 150s, we're selling more of the Pulsars, etc. So the mix change is going in favor over there. As far as the CV business is concerned, as you know that we will end somewhere at about 3.5 in the current year. We see this trend line of the existing no permits in Maharashtra and Delhi opening up, etc., should be a good run for the next 6 to 9 months as well. Cargo vehicles doing well, diesel segment doing well. So here also for the next year, one could look at a growth of about 5%, keeping in mind that this year from a earlier budget of 2,75,000, we are going to go closer to 3.5. The third profitable part of the business is, of course, the domestic spare parts, where again we see a growth of about 10%. So all these businesses, as you are aware, are giving us margins in excess of 20%, and this is positive. As far as the domestic industry is going, I, at this point in time, are fairly and well confident based on this Discover. So if you see, for example, in the current month, in the month of January, we recorded a growth of 36%. But yes, this was on a low base effect of 119,000 of last January for various reasons, including the GST. I would not GST, it was the Bharat 4 chain, sorry, my mistake. The Discover in this month, we have sold 30,000 numbers and we are stock out. Demand and the initial response for the Discover has been very good. So I would say that I would love to see a run rate of close to about 200,000 numbers as an average for the next 2 quarters.
Okay, thanks, Kevin. So in terms of volumes, do you have any targets for next year or any?
No, as of now, we normally work out the target. The board approves it sometime on the middle of March, and that's when we are more free to sort of announce it to everybody. Whatever I'm giving today and to you is more of now guesstimates, which is yet to be confirmed internally, and is all WIP as of this stage.
Okay. And just one question on the results. We had a significant increase in other expenditures. So if you could help us understand what drove that and how to look at it going forward.
Other expenses includes a lot of the CSR spends that is sort of gets added up in a shot over there. So for example, the CSR spend in the third quarter was somewhere about 28 crores of rupees.
Okay.
The total spend of CSR is about 100 crores in a whole year. Most of it gets loaded at the back end because of the projects that we are funding come in for the fund requirement only at the latter part.
Okay. So how much have we CSR we have already done in 9 months?
We would have done approximately about 60 crores, about 40 crores yet to be done in the fourth quarter.
Okay. Okay, Kevin, I'll follow up for more questions.
Sure.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, I would like to remind all the participants, please limit your question to two per participant. You may come back in the question queue if you have a follow-up. Thank you. Next question is from the line of Basudeb Banerjee from Ambit Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, congrats, great set of numbers and great set of volume in January also. Just wanted to know, like earlier as just to discuss in the calls that CT 100 Platina part of your portfolio is more for dealer viability rather than Bajaj Auto as an entity making any margin. So where one should look at this Discover refresh now?
No, let me clarify that the CT and the Platina is, yes, historically we have been making a loss, but we have taken up prices for these products. We have introduced the electric start CT. So in any case, even in the past, on a marginal costing basis, we were making profits. On a full absorption basis, we may have been making a loss. Right now, it's break-even. Keep in mind the price increase that we have taken in August and also in November. As far as the Discover is concerned, it will be making profits, but it will be making in somewhere near the low double digits or single, closer to 9-10% or so.
And as per your planning strategy and marketing distribution people, so can we expect or is it possible to see Discover back to its lakh units per month days, or this will be far lower?
No, I think the marketing head had given at the launch of the Discover site of about 75,000 numbers as the potential of the Discover. Because, and I believe that he had said it is always likely in the near, in about a year's time, he should see the Discover 75,000. I think we would be happy, or I personally would be happy, if I see his Discover stabilizing at least by March, April at 45 to 50,000 numbers. If that stabilizes at that point, then yes, the potential of going to 75,000 is very much there, because that's what the Discover was doing at its peak about 5-6 years back.
Sure, sir. And last question, sir, like so much hue and cry about e-rickshaws everywhere. So any timeline decided yet when it will be launched from your side?
No. As far as the vehicles are concerned, absolutely no comment. Whatever way I can say will come from the MD's office at the appropriate time.
Sure, sir. Okay, thanks.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Amit Parani from Deutsche Bank. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, sir. Thanks for the opportunity. So first, a bookkeeping question. The other income line has seen a significant impact for almost all net cash companies. So is it mostly related to the mark-to-market, and how should we look at it, you know, on a steady state?
I don't know about the other companies, but in my case, it's certainly on account of the mark-to-market. As you know, that we have approximately 13,000 crores of surplus all invested in short-term funds and in FMPs.
Yeah.
And in 31st December, when the yield spiked, automatically the mark-to-market loss gets accounted.
Yeah.
Now, this is the reason why if you see the investment income for 31-12-2016 was 241 crores. The same was there for 39-2017, but it come down to 161.47 in the current quarter.
Yeah.
That is an 80 crore loss. It is a purely MTM loss on that account. Now, because of that,
yeah,
if you see my press release, and this was very important for you all to understand, in the press release I've said that top line has grown by 16%, bottom line has grown by 17%, but profit before tax has gone up by 8%. If you adjust for that 80 crores, you will see that my profit before tax has also gone in line more or less in turnover. The second part also to note is that this 80 crores MTM loss that we are sitting on,
yeah,
is not allowed in the income tax.
Okay.
And therefore, my profit before tax, profit after tax also gets affected by this 80 crores.
And that's why the tax rate is also...
That's why the tax rate is gone up, and therefore the profit after tax is 3%. Now, all these things is, as you know, this company has got the surplus cash. All these things are held to maturity.
Yeah.
We don't trade, and therefore this loss that we are seeing notional gets made up because I'm going to hold it to maturity in any case.
Correct. Correct. So just one accounting understanding. So the interest accrued is accounted for every quarter on these investments, or do you only account for it when you sell it off?
No, it's accrued every thing under Indus right now.
Yeah.
It gets accrued every quarter.
Okay, but at the same time, you have a mark-to-mark profit or loss as well in addition
to that.
That's
right.
Okay. And sir, any outlook on, you know, the kind of capex that you may do either, you know, on products or, you know, R&D in the next 1 or 2 years?
The answer the same between the production lines, the new toolings and the normal capacity expansion would be approximately about 250 to 300 crores every year.
Okay, and there is no increase expected, you know, because of whatever...
The current year and in the next year, no.
Okay. Understood. Thanks for the opportunity. I'll come back.
Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Mahesh Bendre from Carfi Institution Equity. Please go ahead.
Hi, thank you. Thank you for the opportunity. Sir, any plans of launching new models or maybe refreshes of existing one over the next 12 to 18 months?
12 to 18 months is a long time, but therefore I won't be able to comment. Next year, of course, there'll be launches coming, there'll be upgrades and refreshes definitely coming in. But for us, immediately right now, it's the new two Avengers that we have come, the 220 Cruise and Street has come in. One more vehicle from the Avenger family will come in the next probably fortnight or so. And then the Discover is all new. The V family, which required a little bit of upgrades based on feedback, that also has been introduced.
Sure, sir. And, sir, we are at the fag end of this financial year. So, now, next year, for industry as a whole, do you anticipate double-digit growth or any outlook on the industry side?
See, the industry growth as of now is about 11%. And this is coming purely on account of the base effect. So my estimate for the next year would be a conservative 8 to 10% type of situation, more likely to be the 8% rather than the 10%.
And
talking of motorcycles, not of the two-wheelers.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Sonal Gupta from UBS Securities. Please go on.
Hi. Good morning, Kevin. Thanks.
Morning, Sonal. How are you?
I'm very good, sir. Thank you so much. Sir, first, could you share the spare part revenues for domestic and exports?
Spare part revenue for domestic and exports is, of course, earlier what we used to say was including excise duty, and now it is without GST, etc. So I'm just adjusting for that. I would say that the growth has been somewhere near about 19% between quarter three and quarter three of the current year.
Mm-hmm.
Domestic was about 540 crores.
Okay.
Export was about 190 crores
okay.
for the current quarter, as compared to about 430 crores of domestic last year and 185 were exports.
Okay.
Quarter three was reasonable, but in overall export, we lost out in quarter one, purely on account of the GST.
Sure, got you. And Kevin, we've seen very strong growth on three-wheeler side in the export markets, despite Sri Lanka being weak. So could you just talk about which all new markets you've entered and how, and which are the ones which are really contributing and driving to this growth?
As far as the three-wheeler is concerned, Sri Lanka has been more than compensated by Bangladesh, both in motorcycles as well as in three-wheelers. Egypt is doing well, and the growth of three-wheelers is coming primarily from the African continent.
So are we...
Nigeria primarily, yes.
Nigeria is back to 9,000-10,000 sort of a run?
Not 9,000, about 7,000. So total we're doing about 33,000-34,000 two- and three-wheelers in Nigeria, of which three-wheelers would be about 6,000-7,000 numbers, and motorcycles would be about 27,000 numbers.
Right. And also, could you talk about on motorcycles, which are the newer markets and how the growth, what's...
The basic growth is coming from the Philippines.
Okay.
That is in terms of the new market that I'm talking about. Rest, of course, is Turkey is there, Iraq is there, Afghanistan is there, Myanmar is there. These are all the smaller markets, but the growth has come in if I look at the two-wheelers, has come in with the revival of Nigeria from about 12,000, 8,000 motorcycles going all the way up to right now to approximately 27,000 numbers, and Philippines is doing very well.
Okay. And this our plan on ASEAN market entering ASEAN markets remains, right?
So we remain very much so.
So, but have you entered any of those major ones?
It's work in progress right now. So there's small sales taking place. For example, Cambodia three wheelers are doing well. Myanmar we have started, so the big push will come in 1819.
Okay, thank you so much. I'll join back the queue.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Kapil Singh from Nomura Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi Kevin. Just wanted to check what is the implication of BS6 coming in, especially for the three wheeler business.
Kapil, we'll restrict ourselves to the finance question. This I could take offline, please.
Okay, sure.
Because not really a topic of my speciality, so I will be able to share with you offline something.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Nikhil Ranka from Reliance Treasury. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi sir. Congratulations on good set of numbers.
Thank you.
One thing wanted to understand, what is your overall thought process on utilizing the excess cash?
Excess cash remains, I can tell you what we will not do with that, and that is we will not get into equity. We will not get into a buyback. There will not be a special dividend. This is what we will not do. What we could do is whenever an opportunity comes in, we will use this for primarily for the auto business and the two-wheeler and three-wheeler business, which may at some point or the other involve acquisition of a brand or anything else, etc. But we will not be getting into extra dividends, special dividends, or a buyback.
So any specific timeline which we are working with on, you know, efficient utilization of this?
No, not at all. We believe that the cash that is being kept today is in the long-term interest of the company for growth of his own business.
Okay. Thank you very much, and wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Praveen Yolkar from CMB. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, Kevin. This is Pramod here.
Morning, Praveen.
Hi, sir. Wanted to check on two things. What's the status on the commodity cost pressure? And in that context, how do you see the pricing power environment in especially the domestic market?
See, what I'm sharing is my personal opinion. And the way I look at it is, and I've always looked at it, is commodity prices which are there. There is pressure coming in, even in the second quarter, fourth quarter, and going forward in the first two quarters at least, there would be some pressure, especially on steel. But the pressures normally such results in about a 250 rupees or 300 rupees cost increase on a motorcycle, which most of the companies are in a position to pass on to the end customer, because that results in a cost increase of almost about 350 to 400 rupees to the end customer, including taxes. That, I think, today the industry has been in a position to pass on. Having said that, I believe, and I've said this in the past also, that what will actually increase will be the acquisition cost on the customer. That is, you may increase the price, you may increase the basic price to take over the material cost, but there will be pressures on industry to introduce schemes from time to time in order to boost the demand a little bit or to take market share.
Awesome. Sure. And second is with regard to the 3Q margins. In spite of one of the best products.
One second, please. Haan, main call mein hai yaar. Kaun bol, kaun se? Hello? Haan. Just tell Chairman I'm on a conference call with investors. I'll take the call at 11 o'clock, please, 11:15.
Okay.
Thank you. Hi. Yeah.
Sure.
Hi.
Kevin, with regard to the 3Q margins,
yeah,
if you look at the product mix, it's one of the best for three-wheelers and exports on a combination of volumes. So there was a probability that you could have crossed those magic 20% margins. Where you feel was let out?
No, Pramod. You see, let us be clear on one thing. As far as three-wheelers are concerned, let's take it this way. Please understand this again and again. I would like to repeat it. On the export business, I get a margin in excess of 20%. Keeping in mind the fact that there was a growth in exports, there was a growth, despite the fact that there were material costs which I did not pass on, my export margins remained intact. Okay? As far as the three-wheelers is concerned, my three-wheelers, we had a great run, and therefore my three-wheeler margins increased by 1%, which is also over the 20% mark. Now, what happens is, as you go forward, these businesses will continue to grow, and these businesses' growth will be probably 10, 12% or 5%, whatever happens. As we go forward, you will be seeing a much more faster growth rate of the domestic motorcycle with the Discover. Therefore, the overall turnover will go up, the overall profitability will go up, but the profit percentage of the blended weighted average may come off a little bit. Because what is growing is the motorcycle division, which is profits are less than 20%. So one should not look at the total profit, but look at each business vertical and see how it is doing. Now, in the current quarter, with the motorcycles numbers coming off as compared to the second quarter, yes, I lost a little bit of operating leverage over there.
That's helpful. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Jay Kale from Elara Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for taking my question. So my first question is regarding if you can just share your export revenues in USD terms. We've got it in rupee terms, but in USD terms, because it has some of Iran and Nepal.
USD terms I'll trace out, but my realization in USD terms was about 26.9 to the dollar.
Okay. No, sorry. If you can just repeat that, sorry.
It was 66.9 to the dollar.
No, but it will not be exact. Okay, 66.9 accounting for the revenues of Nepal and except the revenues of Nepal and.
That's right.
Okay, and second part is if you can just throw some light on your dollar realization hedge rates for FY19. You know, how covered are we? And whether we would be require any price increases to cover for that?
No, as far as we are taking hedges for quite almost about 75% to 80% of our exports, projected exports for 18-19, and I am assured of a return of about 66% to the dollar.
Okay, so the balance 20% if at all. And any price increases that, if you can just, recollect us, what kind of price increases we took in the last 4-5 months in exports?
By and large, it was not taken. It was taken sometime in about October, where it was about 2-3%.
2-3%. Yeah. Okay, sure. Thank you. Thanks and all the best.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Jinesh Gandhi from Motilal Oswal Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi, Kevin. Continuing on this USD realization exports, so we continue to do range forwards, right?
Yes.
So minimum is 66 and...
I'm not saying minimum is 66. I'm saying I'll based on the spot rate where it stands today,
okay.
We would be able to get 66 even if the rupee falls off from 64.
Right. Understood. And secondly, with respect to our Husqvarna tie-up, so can you give some timelines on that and whether it would be for all the models or how?
That will come in FY21.
Husqvarna?
Yeah.
And Triumph also will be coming in FY21?
Yes, please.
Understood. Okay, Kevin. Thanks and all the best.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, I would like to remind the participants, if you have a question, you may press star and 1 on your touchtone telephone. Next question is from the line of Mahesh Bendre from Carbi Institutional Equities. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity, sir. Sir, on margin side, the commodity prices you mentioned has gone up. So are we, will the current margins be maintained next year?
See, like I said, again, is the margins are based on the business mix that's taking place. And therefore, for the last maybe about 10-12 quarters, I've been showing a 20% margin purely on account of the fact of exports being a major 40% of my total turnover, three-wheelers being 9%, spare parts being 6%, and 40% being domestic motorcycles. If my motorcycle business grows faster than the rest of the business, I will definitely the weighted average of the margin will come down. But what I see is the top-line growth takes place, especially in motorcycles, then I get a significant amount of benefit through the operating leverage. And hence, I feel a 20 to 21% margin is definitely maintainable for the next year as such.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Pramod Kumar from Goldman Sachs. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks a lot for the opportunity, Kevin, and congratulations on a good set of numbers. Kevin, my first question pertains to the domestic market share. We've exited for the December quarter at 16% market share, and Ravi on monthly volume update, sales updates on CNBC has mentioned that you're targeting for 23% exit market share for March. This is even with December month market share being at 14% for motorcycles. So just want to understand, is this strategy of exiting at 22-23% market share is kind of hinging primarily on the Discover launch, because you already said you've done 30,000 this month on a television interview earlier and you're aiming for 40 to 50,000 by March. So I'm just trying to understand where this market share numbers are coming or what is the underlying industry assumptions you're making here.
I would say that the market we are looking at about, if we do in March 2,10,000, we should be somewhere near the 21% market share is what our internal guess is. Now, we are doing right now, as you know, in January, we did 160,000 numbers. We expect the Discover at full capacity to increase it further. The Avenger comes in, which will add certain numbers. We also see in March the CT Platina getting ready for the marriage market. So if I do 2,10,000 by March, we would be somewhere near the 21% market share. Now, this is the call that we're taking right now. But having said that, in case, for example, Hero puts in much more higher numbers, and if Honda puts in much more higher numbers than that, then naturally, as a percentage, we may come off a bit. So when we talk of 21%, we are talking in terms of this 2,10,000 as it stands today.
Can you take
your
call later, sir?
Yeah, carry on, please.
Yeah, sorry. So, Kevin, on the marketing side, so is it only natural to expect that the advertisement and brand building expenses, especially in the domestic market, kind of can keep going up as you support more of the market share comeback strategy on domestic?
100%. And that's what I was saying in the earlier also, and I repeated right now, that for this industry, I personally believe that material cost will really not be so much of a difference, because that will get passed on to the customers, but it will be the acquisition cost of the customer that will affect margins for the industry as such.
Okay, so in a way, we are now focusing basically more on growing the profit pool rather than just focusing on the percentage margin as such, which is probably...
We were never focusing on the margin. The margin, like I have again and again repeating, is a result of the three business verticals.
Yeah. So fair enough, Kevin. Thanks a lot, and best of luck, sir.
Thank you.
We take the next question from the line of Chirag Shah from Edelweiss Securities. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. Kevin, I had a question on exports. So if you look at the African market, how should we look at the ramp-up over there? Because oil has now, for reasonable time, at elevated levels. So when do you think that it starts filtering on the demand side?
It's already started, Chirag. So for example, like I said, we were always doing a peak of about 30,000, 35,000 motorcycles at the retail level. We have almost hit 30,000, 35,000 today. So from a 30,000, 35,000, we have come down to 8,000 numbers in March. We are back to about 27,000, 28,000 numbers this month. So now for years of further growth, one has to look at. So the big surge that was supposed to have taken place has taken place right now. And now as we go forward, a 10-15% growth rate should be doable.
Okay. And beyond 10-12% kind of growth rate, so what would it require?
So it's not something that we can talk so generally, because the penetration of motorcycles over there is so low that if I take a 5-10 year horizon, then I can say that a CAGR of Nigerian 20% is okay, if I'm talking of a 5-10 year projection. But if you're asking me to fix up year by year, it's going to be difficult for me to give a figure. But I would say conservatively a 10-15% growth in Nigeria for over the next 2 years per year is definitely there.
And we can presume that the other African markets can also at similar pace.
I believe so, but you see, it's so difficult when you're talking in terms of this volatility that so many things are possible in a global environment, especially when you're operating in about 60-65 countries. It's not easy to simply put a figure and say that all countries will grow simultaneously. There will be some ups and downs, and therefore, because we are talking 60-65 countries, our business is fairly de-risked. And hence, a 10-12% growth in number terms is something that we feel comfortable to quote. But like I repeat, the actual numbers are WIP. The board will approve them sometime in the third week of March, and that's when we can come out and officially share with you.
No, fair point. It's a very tough task. That's fair point. And second question, Discover. So is there a new strategy or a new approach or new positioning you are looking at? It was because Discover had been a reasonably strong brand. Maybe we can say that not able to live up to its expectation in the recent times. Is there a relook at the way you are positioning the product in the market, or it's more, how do you look at, what gives you confidence that you Discover will come back again in a strong manner?
The confidence is that the brand was always very good. Discover as a product was very well accepted. It was an inspirational brand about 6-7 years back. We were selling 75,000 numbers. Then for reasons we need not get into, because that each one of you all know, is the failure was internal and not external. You know, the customers rejected the Discover, but I think the messaging that we gave on the Discover was wrong, and that took time for us to recover. And with this new product coming in, with the features, with the stylish looks, graphics, etc., the Discover as a brand was strong, and the product is now meeting the aspiration of the customer. Hence, we are very, very optimistic.
Fair point. And there's one last housekeeping question on the raw material side. Is there any impact seen in this quarter results? Or
yes, the percentage is being hidden because of the higher number of three-wheelers and exports.
Is it possible to indicate how much? Is it a large part is already there in the, because, or Q4 can see a reasonably big impact?
Q4 will not see, unlike other competitors, we do our results every quarter. We are steel prices are negotiated. So whatever has been negotiated in the third quarter, once, should see a little bit more of that happening in the fourth quarter, and more importantly, one will see that continuing to go into the first quarter of the next year.
And
so there will be an impact of steel and aluminium in the next two quarters. That's fourth and the first of next quarter.
Fair point. And no price hikes in domestic or exports in this calendar year, in this quarter.
In this quarter, no.
No price hike, right?
No price increase.
Yeah, thank you, and all the best, Chiran.
Thank you, Chiran.
Yeah.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Amreen Pirani from Deutsche Bank. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity again. My question was mainly on your three-wheeler capacity. Given that we should be doing something like 620,000 this year, and you're saying 5% growth in domestic and probably a high single-digit growth in exports.
Capacity is 720,000.
720,000. Includes the capacity which you have for the RE60, right?
That's right.
And it's fungible between the RE60
yes.
and the...
Yes, yes.
And any, sir, any update on the RE60 as of now?
RE60, the only thing is things are progressing favorably, and certain guidelines, etc., have to be announced by the government. But I think what I understand is from whatever we see is Gadkari... as a minister is pretty, it's very helpful.
Okay. And so even for the exports, you've not really, started doing any meaningful numbers?
Export, we're doing nothing meaningful, but one should see a reasonable amount of numbers coming out in the next year. It will be definitely over the 5,000 mark, maybe closer to 10,000. But like again, I say, work in progress.
Okay. Thanks for that.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Sonal Gupta from UPS Securities.
Yeah, Kevin. Thanks for taking my question again. Kevin, just on in terms of the the subvention, etc., or schemes, etc., do they go out of the top line or do they come in your other expenses?
It comes in other expenses.
So is the part of the increase, even if I adjust for like 25, 30 crores for the, CSR, there is an increase.
Another 20 crores has to be adjusted for new licenses under the, for the MIS, SAP licenses.
Okay. Right. No, so I was just trying to understand that X of the CSR, the growth in other expenses more driven by the scale of the business growth, or is there something one-off in there?
Like I said, the one-off is the CSR that I mentioned, and the one-off is 20 crores of the extra licenses that we have taken under SAP.
Okay. And but not not some, nothing very high on subvention side?
Is whatever the subvention will be more in percentage of the sales taking place. And therefore, like I said in my earlier remarks, to the extent the top line did not grow so much in the motorcycles, that burden was the margins came off in motorcycles because of the operating leverage or agreement costs.
Right.
You see, the subvention are variable costs.
Right. And on financing, where would your percentage of sales and financing be from the
I would put it at about 50%.
50%. So that, because previously I've asked you, it's been more like 40%, 35%.
Right. So that's why I'm saying right now 50% because I'm taking the BFL numbers.
Mm-hmm.
What is there, especially when you're offering the subventions and when you're offering all these items, naturally the percentage of financing goes up. So a lot of cash customers move to the subvention.
Okay. And just, Kevin, lastly, any thoughts on the Pulsar category as a whole? I mean, that category, while has been a most sluggish over the last 3-4 years, I mean, not just the brands, but the category as a whole. So any thoughts there? I mean, is the customer just upgrading to 350 and that's why this is sluggish? Or are there any other factors, do you think, which is the reason for this sluggish growth in this segment?
I won't be able to answer that sooner. I've not applied my mind so much to that, but maybe offline I will just think it over and give you a call.
Okay, Kevin. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Vinay Singh from Enam Asset Management. Please go ahead.
Thank you so much. Firstly, congratulations on the good set of results. I have just one question. And if you look at the three-wheeler market, obviously it's been buoyed a lot because of what's happened in terms of the permits given. Now the question here is, how long do you see the pent-up demand pushing us in terms of volume sales? And what happens 1 year forward, when the pent-up demand is done? What do you think the volume sales would be then? Thank you so much.
So I would say that looking at the pent-up demand, I would say that this run rate at least up to July should happen. Post that, what is there in terms of visibility will be, of course, the demand-supply situation that will take place. And given it's a good employment generation part, I think the sales should be pretty okay, but not as high as what we're seeing today as a run rate. But as you go forward, there are other states, for example, Delhi, which has got still a lot of permits pending for the release. This Karnataka that is likelihood to do away with permits, but maybe I can't make a statement in that form. So at least for the next 1.5 to 2 years, I see the three-wheelers being pretty healthy in terms of number form. Also, what I'd like to say that the entire growth in three-wheelers has not come only because of the petrol and alternate fuel vehicles, but we have done well in the cargo vehicles as well. From 600 numbers, we've gone to about 2,500 numbers. Secondly, is the diesel segment where we are taking up our market share from 24% to 31%. So while definitely the growth has been driven by petrol or alternate fuel vehicles, I think a lot of progress is also happening on the other portions.
So if I were to push my luck, if you were to look 2 years forward, is 30 or 35,000 number per month possible? Is it 30? What would be your ambition? 35,000?
I would put it at 30,000.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Chirag Shah from Edelweiss Securities. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity again. Kevin, just a basic rundown on the price hike that we have done in this financial year, both in domestic and in exports, if you can just help us.
I know the price increase that we made in May.
Yeah.
Second price increase was sometime in end of August, September. And a third price increase was made in November first week. And each of the price increases was approximately about 350 to 400 rupees per product.
And this is for both domestic or export?
This is for domestic.
And what about exports?
Export, like I said, is one increase has been made of approximately 2 to 3%.
But that's only one increase, right?
Yes.
Right. And so second question was, Kevin, again on three-wheelers on the domestic side. So on the permits, which are the other states you think are likely to come up or the potential over the next 2-3 years as far as permits opening or doing up with permit system is concerned?
Right now it's Delhi.
Yeah.
Opportunity then Karnataka.
Okay.
Especially Bangalore.
Okay. And anything else apart from this?
Apart from this, very difficult to give a call at this stage. But I know that these are the ones that are pretty warm in terms of generating sales.
And so none of the smaller states or smaller cities which are or tier two cities and which are looking to do introduce this kind of thing or anything of that sort?
There won't be a substantial volumes over there because there's only Calcutta and Tamil Nadu after that.
Okay, this was really helpful. Thank you and all the best.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Devraj Mota from Fidelity Investment. Please go ahead.
Hi, Kevin. Good morning.
Morning.
One question for me. Just wanted to understand, you spoke about the outlook for exports in Africa. Could you just talk about the outlook for Latin America and as well as the other Asian countries?
As far as Latin America is concerned, it will be a little subdued. So because these are markets which have been, we have already got market leadership over there. So your gaining market share would be limited. It's only the expansion in the market that will drive growth. Hence, I'm saying that in these markets, it will be in single digit is more likely.
Okay. And in Asia?
In Asia, there's the opportunity coming because Philippines is doing very well. And we are getting into working through Malaysia, etc., for penetrating greater into the ASEAN zone. So I think the growth for the significant growth that we're talking about for exports, like I said, about 10 to 12%, will be driven primarily from Africa and Asia, the ASEAN
right.
zone.
And if I may just one more follow-up.
Tata
with
Motors.
Regard to, you know, you're saying LATAM will be subdued.
Tata Motors,
so which means that
Bosch,
in terms of
result
the ASP mix for the export segment, it would be bad because, I mean, typically Latin America is where you'll sell the higher end.
Correct. But there again, what's happening is I see a greater opportunity in three-wheelers.
Okay.
And again, like I mentioned earlier, in Africa also from the Boxer 100, you have moved to the Boxer 150.
Okay. Sure. That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Prayesh Jain from IIFL Wealth. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good morning, Kevin. Just one question on is there any disparity between growth in rural and urban in domestic market?
No, actually, I have not seen any much significant change over there. But if I was to take a call and I'm speaking as an individual and not necessarily on behalf of the company, I would say that at least now going forward in the urban area, it will be the replacement cycle. And hence, higher-end products that will command a greater sort of sale than the rural markets. Again, when I'm talking about rural markets, I would see that people are not moving from the spoke wheel to the kickstart and electric start. All of them are moving to the alloy wheel electric start motion. So people are jumping the value chain and going up in that direction.
Okay. And secondly, on the premiumization trends, do you think that, you know, there is a possible faster growth in the higher CC categories relative to the entry and the executive level categories?
Yes, but at the same time, I'm putting it with the rider. One needs to see what happens when the Bharat 6 norms come into play.
Okay. And is there any delay on a Husqvarna launch? Because earlier we were talking about 19-20 and now we're talking about 21.
No, I'm talking about basically calendar year 20.
Okay.
So from a okay. point of view, I'm saying FY21.
All right. Okay. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Yogesh Agarwal from HSBC. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi. Good morning, Kevin.
Morning.
Just quick question from me on export market. So, you know, you have done incredibly well managing margins despite the weakness last couple of years and then the currency impact, etc. So when eventually things improve, can we expect margins much higher than 20% or you would like to keep it in that range?
At company level or export level?
Export level.
Export level, I never said 20. I said it's in excess of 20.
Yeah, so will it be much higher than the existing margins or you would...
No, I don't think so. There is no need to do that. I think the main thing is to make the vehicle affordable, spread out the vehicle product, etc. So, again, let me put it. When I'm competing with the Japanese, then my margins are significantly higher than what's there in the domestic market for the same product. It's only in Africa, etc., where it is the affordability, the Chinese product, etc., where the margins are higher than the domestic product, but not so way in that high growth of 25% or so plus. So for us, as we go forward, it is how do you sort of make the vehicle affordable, offer them warranty, offer them services, and get a distinct differentiation point versus the Chinese.
Okay, got it. And then just... you know, your Nigeria is still the biggest. Would it be possible for you to share the next few markets in terms of absolute sales for motorcycles, export markets, I mean?
I won't be able to share individual-wise, but let me put it this way that I can give you a breakup.
Yeah.
If you take up Latin America, it will form about 18% of our total sales. ASEAN, that is Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, etc., would be another 20%. Africa would be about 40%. And balance coming, when I said SAME, that was of earlier 20%, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Nepal, Egypt, and the rest will be ASEAN.
Okay, got it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Amin Pirani from Deutsche Bank. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi sir. So just wanted to know what will be your dealership network or distribution network size right now, and how has it moved over the last 1 year?
We would have approximately about 645 or 650 main dealers.
Okay.
And each of them would have some ASDs, etc., authorized sales US service centers. So we would have approximately about 3,000 odd touch points.
Okay. And this is sales plus service, everything?
Yes.
And I mean, how has this changed over the last 1 year, increased or decreased or like flattish?
It is more or less flattish. There has been a churn among the dealerships.
Okay.
And when I say flattish, I'm saying it because many of the service points have become main dealers.
Okay.
But by the end of this year, we should be somewhere near about, or let's say by June, we should be somewhere near the 700 mark.
Okay, so touch points would also increase to 3,300, 3,400.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Raghunandan from MK Global. Please go ahead.
Thanks, sir, for the opportunity. On the ABS-CBS, is it becoming mandatory from April 18, and what is the kind of price impact you see? Thanks, sir.
So when I say April 18, it's only for the new products.
Understood, sir. And for the existing products
that are already there in the market today will not get covered. It's only the new products that get introduced after April 18 that gets covered.
And so for the existing products, it's April 19?
Yes.
And what would be the kind of price increase if you
won't be able to share that with you because it depends on different parameters. So right now, I won't like to comment on that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, if you wish to ask a question, you may press star and one on your touchtone telephone. Next question is from the line of Chinal Seth from Multi.